We are going live now on YouTube. So I would request Jyoti Prakash to continue with the initial formalities of the interview session. Jyoti Prakash, we are going live now on YouTube. So you can continue with the initial formalities of our session.
Thank you, Dinesh. Good afternoon, everyone. This is Jyoti Prakash, co-founder of Index Financial. I welcome you all on behalf of my team to this edition of Index Financial Sunday series. So before I introduce the eminent guest of this afternoon, I must tell you the purpose behind organizing this amazing series. So this the basic vision behind the interview series is to facilitate and provide the legal fraternity with some invaluable anecdotes and escapades of several legal luminaries and dons. So we always know that experiences are invaluable and non-inheritable. Yet these precious anecdotes must be shared and preserved to serve as a guiding light for the generations to come. So we truly believe that the stories of struggles, legal adventures, and unequal display of skills of advocacy must be conveyed to all the members of the fraternity, and more specifically to the budding ones. And after all, our endeavor is always to create some positivity and motivation amidst this toxic environment that is prevailing due to this global pandemic COVID-19. So today we are fortunately joined by Mr. Divyakant Lahoti, advocate on record, Supreme Court of India. Sir, I welcome you on board for this interview session. Thank you for joining us. So before we proceed with this particular interview session, I will give a brief introduction of our honorable guest for the convenience of all the audience. So, sir, is a third generation lawyer and an advocate on record in the Supreme Court.
I think there is an internet connection problem with him. Just a second. Anyway, so I think it will take him some time to join this session. So I would like to go with the introduction of sir, and sorry everyone and sir for this interruption.
No problem.
Thank you, sir. So as he was introducing our honorable guest of today's evening, Mr. Divyakant Lahoti, sir. So he is a third generation lawyer and an advocate on record in the Supreme Court of India with a wide range of legal with an exposure of to a wide range of legal dispute. Divyakant sir is one of the leading advocates on record in the Supreme Court of India. He was featured as a super lawyer in 2016 and acknowledged as an aged young legal professional in the recent book On the Rise. Recently at the ICCA Residential Conclave 2019, the Indian Corporate Counsel Association has recognized the efforts of Divyakant sir towards the law and his commitment to the role he plays in both business and society. Divyakant sir is also acclaimed as the shining star of Indian legal fraternity by the Corporate Counsel Association of India at Udaipur in September 2019. More recently, in July 2020, Divyakant sir's excellence in the sphere of arbitration has been recognized by the renowned international magazine Finance Monthly by awarding him Finance Monthly Merger and Acquisition Award 2020, Alternative Dispute Resolution Lawyer of the Year, India. Divyakant sir has also been recognized by the Business World magazine as one of the top 40 lawyers under the age of 40. So we are really fortunate to have you, sir, for this particular interview session today's afternoon, and I am sure that it will be a great session, and you will be giving us lot of pointers, lot of anecdotes, and lot of advices for our viewers, including both me and Jyoti Prakash. So, with your due permission, sir, I would like to continue, or rather, I would say, begin with the interview session.
Yes, Devashish, it's a pleasure to be present today on the platform like Cognizant and appear before all of you and share my little experience with the audience here, and whatever experience that I have earned, if that can help our youngsters, our young lawyers, that would be very great.
Indeed, sir. So continuing with the first phase of this interview session, I would like to ask you about your childhood, family upbringing, and then how you came to pursue law as your career.
Devashish, the career path which one chooses molds the way of his living and everyone around him. The habitats has a huge role in playing and shaping one's life, and the situation is no different for me. I gained a positive perspective of the profession when I closely observed my father work in our office, which was attached to our house. It was an opportunity for me to closely observe an advocate's profession and his life. Though it so happened that as we start pass through various stages of early life, we all have plethora of options which entice us to join that particular profession or join that particular business or that avenue. But such was not the case with me. My aim was well formulated from my very childhood. In the enlightening presence of my father, Justice K.K. Lahoti, which I could feel, which he enjoys in the society and the courtrooms, shaped my inclination. And this thought became deeply imbibed in me, that from the very early stage that I thought that there is no other enterprising or gratifying career option than the law. And the greatest motivating factor that drew to me to this particular profession was to witness the amount of respect one earns and the satisfaction that he brings one to the client once he attained justice for them. And for that particular purpose, the client reposed trust and his life onto the hands of a lawyer. It was inspiring to witness the hope and the optimism that an advocate instills in his client in their quest of justice. So that was the very beginning that actually prepared me to become a lawyer.
That was quite interesting to know about your childhood and how you come to pursue law as your career. And as you said, your father was your inspiration for that purpose. So now we would like to know that in which college you have studied your graduation, that is LLB, you have completed your LLB degree, and what did you do after that?
I did my schoolings from Gwalior and my class 12th from Jabalpur. And then it was a transition for me from Jabalpur to Delhi in the year 2003. My college was University School of Law and Legal Studies, which is the university college of Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University. I did LLB honors, which is a 5 years course from that during the period between 2003 and 2008.
Indeed, sir. As you said that you have graduated from Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, the law school of that university per se. So how was your law school days at your alma mater, and whether you have indulged yourself in various co-curricular activities like moot court or debating or any other kind of thing?
See, it was a transition for me from a tier two city to the national capital, and there was a sea of difference between these two cities. Initial months went by to understand the changes both socially and culturally, made some good and some best friends for life. College education actually opens your mind. You are free to think and adapt to the worldly affairs. You need to be street smart and mold yourself to the new environment. That is very important, and that's college education gives to you. We were involved in various co-curricular activities to expand our horizon and the thought process. Not only we should participate in moot courts and other competitions like elocution or legal quizzes and debates, but we should also actively engage ourselves in organizing moot court competitions, debates, maybe within your city or at a national level. Co-curricular activities is an important activity, and it is as important as academics. If you need to evolve, both are necessary. Academics makes you knowledgeable, but what I think is co-curricular activities makes you great, and it develops your personality. Your entire personality changes if you do co-curricular activities and not restrict yourself to academics. One more thing which I would like to tell, that while attending one of the seminars during my college time, and which has a reflection in my memory, there was a shayari competition which happened, and there was one poet who came, and because it was organized by a law school, so he was reading poetry on lawyers also. Some was hilarious, some were deep, but one of the shayari which actually depicts the current situation of backlog of cases due to which various clients and litigants are suffering, he beautifully captured in a humorous manner. He said, if I recollect it correctly, he says, "Vakil ki shaksiyat ka andaaz tum kya lagaoge galib? Vakil ki shaksiyat ka andaaz tum kya lagaoge galib? Jab ve shamshan se bhi guzarte hain, to murda bhi poochte hain, vakil sahab, hamara mukadma kya nipta ya nahi?" So that thought is amongst each and every litigant which is fighting litigation in Indian courts, and that's the problem that each and everyone, as a budding lawyer or as an established lawyer or as a judge or a stakeholder in justice delivery system, we should endeavor to resolve and do whatever best we can do to resolve this particular problem. For example, even if you are a lawyer, instead of taking long dates, you can always request the judge that, "My lords, could you please give me a short date because of XYZ reasons." Don't try to delay cases, because ultimately the case is not yours. The case is of your client, and you are not suffering. It's the client who is suffering. And this particular moment which motivated me also to do some betterment for justice delivery system. I've been trying to improve justice delivery system in whatever manner possible, by organizing informative webinars, seminars, workshops for all stakeholders on the system. And I firmly believe that even the smallest of steps can lead to a huge revolution, either it is by a law student or by a lawyer or by a senior advocate or by a judge. So we should do our cup of tea.
Indeed, sir, you have pointed out a very important aspect of justice delivery system, and that as young budding lawyers and young legal professionals, those who are viewing this particular interview must keep in their mind, so that it will not be a hectic and delayed process, rather than it would be a smooth and easier and timely process, which will help us clients as well as us. So that is, that's a great point. And again, you have highlighted about organizing events in your college days, which will make you street smart, and then participating in co-curricular activities, which will save you in a overall manner as a great personnel. So
not these only pointers are you really friends. Debashish, not only that will make friends, but it also a very good platform for networking. And ultimately, what a lawyer needs is networking, through which the clients will come to you. If you are doing a good job, your friends would recommend their friends to come to you if they have any case law or any legal problem. And if you are doing well and doing your job honestly, that's the sign which a client would look for, so that he can repose trust in you.
Indeed, sir. Indeed, sir. Now we would like to know about the internship at your days, like in which all organizations or firms you have done your internship, and if you can tell our viewers, as most of them are young students, law students, the importance of doing internship during the course of your law school.
Yes. See, internships are sine qua non with college studies. They are indispensable. I always made it a point to spend most of the time that I had during the college to learn the law practically. It's very important. We all talk about clinical education. This is clinical education where you do internships. But the methodology of doing an internship is very important. How do you do an internship? It's not just you go to some random place and do internship. You have to be well structured and well thought about where you want to do those internships, which will ultimately shape your career. I was clear that I want to pursue my career in litigation. I had the esteemed opportunity to learn from some of the finest minds of the fraternity, like KK Venugopal sir, Fani Nariman sir, Raveen Anand sir, Sunil Gupta sir. All of them were senior advocates, and I used to carry books, files, and run behind them because they used to have tens of cases every day from one court to another. And the thing that ultimately appealed to me about all these great personalities is, apart from law, obviously they are legal stalwarts and jurists, but an eye for fact. They were so thorough with the facts, which will demolish any argument of the other side, and that's why they are great. So I recommend that, for example, many people, although they join legal profession, but they are clueless about where to do internship, how to do internship, how to apply for internship. However, what I suggest is there are broadly two strategies of doing it. Number one is that if you're very clear that you want to either apply for a judgeship or you want to go into litigation, then it is always better that you start the internships from the very first year. And if you can, and if you get the opportunity, then also do internship after your college every day, which I used to do. That will give you legal practical exposure along with academic exposure. What you are learning in the college, you can and you will be able to put into practice when you go to a lawyer's chamber in the evening after attending college. And more importantly, once you go to a lawyer's chamber and do those internships, you will understand how do you apply those laws to practice, which is very important.
Indeed, sir. As you rightly pointed out, that internship is sine qua non for young law students during their law school studies. So I hope this particular advice will be adhered by our viewers. So now,
one more thing, Debashish. In fact, many people who are clueless, I forgot to address that issue. Many people are clueless, maybe because their college is not informing them, or they do not have appropriate background, and they are first generation budding lawyers. If they are confused where to do internship, when to do internship, and how to apply for those internships, the golden rule for them is do internships, one with a judge, one with a lawyer, one with a senior advocate, one with a advocate on record, one with any law firm, another with a corporate entity, and one with any NGO. If you divide your internships in all these horizons, then you would understand and you would have a fair idea. And if you're doing your internship honestly, that is very important. Just for the certificate, don't do internship. Do internship to learn, because ultimately this learning is going to help you when you actually enter into the profession. And when you do all these internships, you would be clear in your head where you have to go and where you don't have to go. If you don't like litigation experience in a litigating firm, you might say that I think litigation is not my cup of tea, but I think I should apply for judgeship. Or I think if I sit in a corporate office, I can do justice not only to my employer, but also to myself, that yes, this is the area where I want to work. I feel happy to work. I love to work in this area. So this will eliminate all those choices which you don't want to do. So eliminate those which you don't want to do, then you will have a shorter perspective of where you want to do. And then you can do one or more internships to understand, yes, and to confirm your choice. Yes, this is the area where I have to go. But utilize all 5 years. If you are doing a 5 years course in doing internship, that will help you a lot.
Indeed, sir. Exposure at various forums will surely help you decide what you want to pursue in your career after your graduation, as you rightly pointed. Now coming to this point that you have done your LLM from King's College of London. So we are quite excited to know that why did you decide to hold your post-graduation from a foreign university, and what was your specialization in any other special aspect that you want to shed light upon?
The quench for specialized knowledge persuaded me to do and attend an LLM course from King's College London. I specialized in international commercial law. More importantly, why I did LLM from a foreign university at that time was, firstly, it was a one-year course. You save 1 year's time, because in India at that time, it was a 2 year's course. So the faster you do your LLM, the more time you have to practice. And at the same time, earning a similar qualification. That is number one. Number two is the exposure that you get in a foreign university and the way they structure their curriculum, which we find it difficult in most of the colleges in India, but many good colleges are now adopting the similar exhaustive curriculum. Then is the study pattern and the teaching methodology. One thing which I find surprising over there when I went there, the teachers, and that's very important, teachers are not merely academicians. They are the practicing lawyers or judges who are coming to teach. They have firsthand information about the development of law, how they are practicing such law, and what current trends are there and how the law is changing. That is number one, which actually made me to do a LLM from those universities. I did a lot of research which college to choose, because that is also a very cumbersome exercise. Ultimately, you have many good colleges, but you have to choose which college is providing what subjects, and whether you want to pursue those subjects from that university or from some other university. So you do a three-layer screening. Number one, who's teaching you? Very important, because you have names of all the teachers who are teaching you on the website of these universities. Then whether you want to study that particular area of law. And number three, if those two areas you have shortlisted, then shortlist which is the best university which is having these two criteria which are fulfilled. Now, I'll give you an example. I studied international arbitration from King's College, and one of my professor was Professor Martin Hunter. He is a legend. He was a legend, and we read his books even today. Even when we argue arbitration matters before arbitrators or before High Court or Supreme Court, we cite him. Similarly, Professor V.V. Weeder. He is again an authority, a Queen's Counsel in UK, who was one of the greatest arbitrators and lawyers in UK and in European Union. Then I will tell you another interesting gentleman, Professor Ravi Tenukuni. And he was teaching us international finance. And he was also at that time director of ABN AMRO Bank. I'm talking about 2008 and 9, when the Great Depression in US took place, the controversy surrounded about subprime loans. And his bank was also involved in all those transactions. Now, and he being a professor as well as a director, a lawyer who's dealing with that situation, teaching us why that situation has emerged, what we are doing to tackle that situation, how we are developing the law and suggesting to the government that this is the best way to do a damage control. And this would be the future, how to deal with these problems in future, if at all they arise. Now, these kind of people, if they teach you, apart from academicians, it will give you confidence. It will give a right insight about the legal profession. So that is very important. And I think now even in India, most of the colleges are inviting guest faculties, guest professors, professor emeritus to adopt a similar line of teaching. If a lawyer teaches you, I'm not saying that if a professor or an academician is teaching you, he's lesser or something. But from point of view of a practitioner and from a point of view of a litigator, if he is teaching you the practical aspects of law, you will able to correlate with actual situations. That's why that is one of my criteria in joining this particular college, because I saw the list of teachers who would be teaching me, imparting education, and they don't used to come and give lectures, which actually was a trend during my days. They used to give you a reading material, maybe a 500 to 1000 pages. The classes would be only two classes a week. That's it. But for those two classes, you have to read over 1000 pages. And then there would be a discussion during the class about those 1000 pages, about the legal propositions, debate for or against on those legal principles. The professor will tell you that why this proposition have evolved, what is the historical perspective, what is the current perspective, and what should be the future perspective, because law is dynamic, it's developing with the change in society. So all this, if we adopt in India, which we are doing nowadays, will help the young lawyers and students of law to understand the law in a better manner, in a more practical manner.
Indeed, sir. I hope the answer to this particular question will help law students from our country to decide as to which college they should go in terms of foreign universities and what all criteria they should check before going there or before enrolling there.
One more thing, you know, why this research is very important, because you are spending lakhs of rupees either by taking loans or from your parents or from your near and dear ones. And ultimately, after completing that education, you have to repay it to them. Even if it's your parents or your family members, or if you have taken a bank loan. So don't take that as a paid holiday and going to a foreign university. Take it as an opportunity to learn new laws, make new friends, understand their culture, and discuss the changes or the differences between their culture and our culture. So people are very receptive when an Indian student goes there, and they get fascinated by Indian culture. So if you are going there, then boast about our culture. You should be knowledgeable about your culture, and then only you can boast about your culture. So read Indian culture and literature. It's very important.
Indeed, sir. Now again, we have come to know that you have pursued a 2 years course in specialization in IPR from University of South Africa and WIPO after doing this specialization in international commercial laws. So yes. What was the purpose behind that, and how was your experience and all?
I think I did that in 2010 and 11. So, I was thinking that, all right, I have done gained education in international commercial law. But I also want to be educated on intellectual property rights, so that whenever I start my practice, I should be able to handle those cases. So I first enrolled for a general course on intellectual property rights with WIPO. WIPO is World Intellectual Property Right Organization, which is based in Geneva. I completed that course. That was a certificate course. Then I enrolled because the course was very fascinating. So I said that, all right, now I know the basics. Let me do an advanced course. And it was a paid course. I paid for it. The general course was free, of course, and everyone should do it. All the students who are listening, they must do it. It's a very good course. But if you have more inclination, then you can do advanced courses. And the fee of that advanced courses for India is slightly lesser than other European countries, students who are coming from there. So I did that course. And at the end of that course, they test your capabilities or what you have learned on the basis of a written examination. So I took that examination and cleared with the flying colors. And I think I was amongst the two people who were granted scholarship by WIPO to do this 2 year specialization program at University of South Africa. It was a completely online examination, and we were just told that the entire course curriculum would be given to you through emails, and you have to write examinations, you have to attend lectures through your computer. And at the end, if you are successful in completing that course, then you would be called to, I think, Johannesburg for award of this certificate. So I felt really happy and privileged to do that course, which was otherwise very expensive. And WIPO was gracious enough to grant me 100% scholarship for doing that course.
Yeah. That is again an interesting aspect regarding IPR laws and interest in IPR laws per se. Now, as we know a lot of things about your childhood, about your law school, about your PG and then specialization courses. Now I would like to know from you that in which year you have enrolled in the bar, and how was your initial days, and what did you do during the practice period?
So after completing my graduation in the year 2008, I enrolled myself on 4th July 2008 with the Bar Council of Delhi. And thereafter, in the year 2007, I applied for LLM with many universities in UK as well as US, including one National University of Singapore. But since I was selected at King's College, I decided that let's do LLM from King's, being centrally located in London, and London being a commercial and a financial hub in UK, it would be better that I can gain experience from that particular university. Apart from what I have already said in your previous question about the courses and the professors and all that. So that was also an important consideration. Thereafter, after coming from King's, I did not jump into the profession immediately, but I started working with my guru, Justice R.C. Lahoti, who was a former Chief Justice of India. And I think the foundation was laid under his guidance, wherein I joined his office as an associate. And I firmly believe that those formative years made my character. I worked day and night to absorb as much as possible from such a great personality and jurist. And one thing which I want to share with you all is three lessons which I learned from him. Number one is work is worship. Number two, that it is never too late to learn, whether you are in your 20s or 30s, 40s, 50s, or maybe post-retirement, it's never late to learn. Third, on a professional aspect, if you have accepted an assignment, put your 100% and heart to it. And never compromise on two things. Anything less than the best, and your work ethics and professionalism. I worked with him for about an year, although I am still assisting him in many of his arbitrations and opinion works. But in 2010, I think somewhere in April or May 2010, I joined Luthra and Luthra Law Offices, New Delhi, as an associate. Later, I think in August 2012, I was promoted as a senior associate there. And I worked there till I think March 2013 before I started my own independent practice and started my firm. Yes. You also asked me about, I forgot the question, the second part of the question, Debashish, which you asked me.
Sir, I asked you regarding your initial days of practice. Like, how
yes.
was that?
So, it's no rocket science, Debashish, to decipher that a firm gives you necessary skills and experience to commence an independent legal practice. However, what you would require is to hone your entrepreneurial skills and lawyering skills capabilities before you actually jump into the profession on your own. So for me, it was a well contemplated decision to switch from a leading law firm to open my own firm. Undoubtedly, that decision was a life changing decision for me, and it did put me in an independent position. Now, what we have to understand is that self-sufficiency comes from obvious need to be accountable and carry the entire venture on our own shoulders. However, one of the major advantages of going independent is more opportunity to appear and argue the matters yourself before various courts and tribunals, do variety of work and litigation, maybe litigation, transactional work, and make yourself a brand of yourself. Moreover, in independent practice, you tend to handle more clients simultaneously, unlike in a firm where you would be assigned to limited matters or to a limited clients. Undisputably, there is a more flexibility in an independent practice when it is compared with a firm where you are working as an associate or as a senior associate or a managing associate. Now, in an independent practice, you have ample power and luxury of choosing what matters you want to involve yourself with. However, in the initial year of practice, you tend to do whatever comes your way. Whether you want, if the client is coming to you to take you to a Munshif court or to a revenue authority or for doing a registration of his will, XYZ, you do everything. You understand the process. You understand how those things are also done. That's why it is very important. And even when I was there in Lutheran Lutra, I used to make it a point that whenever a case is being filed from the firm in which I am involved, I used to go with the court clerk to understand how it is being filed, what are the procedures that are involved in filing, what is the court fee that is needs to be affixed in filing a particular petition or a plaint, where to file it, how to clear the defects, and ultimately get it registered. And then the challenge comes to get it listed. So the entire thing needs to be learned. All these things are never taught in the law college. This you have to learn once you go independent or you are working with somebody else. However, so in the initial years of practice, you tend to do whatever comes your way to sustain a living. But thereafter, once you are established, you have the liberty to accept or deny the matters according to your sensibility, interest, or develop specialized area or specialized area of practice. Now, one of the major aspects of going independent is to basically choose a location of your office which is accessible to the courts. So accessibility to the courts has to be determined while finalizing the location of the office where you want to set it up. It is important that you have a well-equipped office with basic amenities and essential facilities with a resourceful library. Nowadays, you have all those softwares which can replace a physical library like SCC, Westlaw, LexisNexis, but having a physical book and a commentary has its own charm. Now, once you identify the location of your office, which is short distance, try to identify which is closer to the court where you practice so that the travel time is minimized. And you put that travel time into more productive work. Because ultimately, in a lawyer's profession, this banked time which you have saved comes handy in other significant and productive activities. Then comes, we all have watched Sherlock Holmes. So Sherlock Holmes has Dr. Watson with him all the time. So just like Sherlock needs Watson, a lawyer needs a good and competent court clerk who has good knowledge about court procedures and filing and getting it listed before the court. Ultimately, if you can get the matter filed but not able to get the matter listed before the court, then you may not be able to get the relief as early as possible. So the entire process is very important, and if you have a competent law clerk, he will ensure that not only it is filed expeditiously, but it is also listed before the court expeditiously. Then it's your job. And once you have all these vital things ready with you, then comes the brandification of your name, establishing your own brand amongst your clients and courtroom. That is the foremost real task. Independent practice, according to me, encompasses not only getting new clients, Devashish, but also to retain them. And this is no secret that a fiduciary relationship between a client and a lawyer lasts only till that trust lasts. Such trust and faith with your client has in you must be kept at its prime all the time. So that cannot be broken. It's non-negotiable. Along with retaining a client, you also need to maintain a sustainable cash flow, because ultimately you have to run your office. Reposing trust is on one hand, then invoicing and then recovering your fee from that client is also important. And it's a challenge in itself to recover a fee from a client. A lot of productive time is wasted in recovering the professional fee. However, such recovery is also as important as pitching for a new client. Otherwise, if you don't get your fee, ultimately your labor is wasted. The last thing which I think is very important in setting up your own independent practice is having a team. Once a good practice is established and the clients have started to come in, the matters will be listed in various courts or tribunals at the same time. And this particular obstacle, because many times we go to one court and we are arguing the matter in that court, and the other court in which you have another matter comes, then ultimately either you loses that particular matter or that matter gets passed over. So this obstacle can be overcome by forming a team of Avengers. By Avengers means a team of good lawyers, good budding lawyers, maybe freshers, who can synergize their competence with yours and work as a team. And your team is going to be your sword as well as your shield. They will give you enough ammunition for arguments to win a case and defense arguments at the right time to protect and shield your client. Many times it happens because you are new in profession, your juniors might commit mistakes, which we all do in our initial years. In fact, we do those mistakes even when you are a senior advocate or a judge. But when your junior is doing a mistake, please correct him and protect him from aspirations which are casted upon him. It is also very important for team building. Do not fire them or throw them out because of a mistake. Because ultimately, these young lawyers are the future of our legal profession. It is our golden duty that not only we teach them, but we also tell them that where they have committed a mistake and how to correct it. It doesn't matter if you have committed a mistake, but you have to own it up. And then, even if you have done a mistake in a particular court of law, then there are always avenues of appeal against that order. But that doesn't mean that you lambast your juniors. So I firmly believe that once you have a very good team and these fundamentals are at play, one is good to go. And a healthy work environment is created for an effective and efficient working. This work environment should inspire all the colleagues to to dream more, learn more, do more, and become a lawyer more. It is the team efforts that paves a path of success and prosperity.
Indeed, sir. A great team is necessary to succeed in life and succeed in a better way. And I hope this particular answer will be remembered by everyone in future, in everyone who is willing to set up their firm in future. And as you said, being a humble mentor is necessary, as always, in the present time, because even I have seen that there are seniors who are not so humble in rectifying our small mistakes. So that is also a great point that you have highlighted.
We need leaders, not bosses, in our profession.
Now I would like to call upon Jyoti Prakash Datta. He has a few couple of questions relating to your uncle and your father, and then about your AOR exam and all, and which are quite necessary for our viewers. So he will be asking the second phase of questions to you. So yes. Jyoti Prakash, can you please come to the studio? Yes. So Jyoti Prakash, yes, you may continue.
Thank you.
I would request all our viewers to stay tuned with us. This second phase will be very, very interesting, and as there will be unearthing of a lot of anecdotes from our honorable guest Divyakant Lahoti, sir. So please stay tuned with Jyoti Prakash and sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Devasis. Thank you. Sir, I first of all apologize for the repeated network interruptions from my side. I apologize for
that. No problem. We all faces these internet outages every day. So it doesn't matter.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Sir, I was listening to the conversation between you and Devasis. Those questions were really very much interesting, and you have lucidly answered every question. So with your permission, I will start the second phase.
Yes, please.
Yes, sir. Sir, as Devasis has questioned you about your early childhood days, after that you, how you joined your LLB and how you specialized and did your PG, and after that how you started your practice, as well as the intricacies involved in independent practice. Now I want to know from you, what is the difference between a normal advocate and an advocate on record? As we know, you are an advocate on record in the Supreme Court of India. So when did you pass the AOR examination, and what are the intricacies involved in this particular process, and how it is different from being a normal advocate?
Okay. So I put it that every advocate on record is an advocate, and not every advocate is an advocate on record. Now, there is a special distinction which is conferred by Supreme Court on lawyers who have attained a particular year of years of experience and cleared an examination. I believe Order 4 of Supreme Court rules deals with the advocate on records. Now, advocate on records can appear, act, and plead in Supreme Court on behalf of the clients. However, a lawyer or an advocate can appear before Supreme Court, but he cannot plead or file a case in Supreme Court, for which he requires an advocate on record. That is number one. There is a process of becoming an advocate on record. You have to first enroll yourself and start your training with an experienced advocate on record who has more than 10 years of experience. So you have to first submit a certificate of commencement of training with an advocate on record before the Supreme Court. Then you have to train with him for a period of 1 year at least. And this is once you have an experience of 4 years at least. So you have an experience of 4 years as an advocate, then you are eligible to start a formal training with an advocate on record and submit the certificate of training before the Supreme Court. after this training is complete for at least 1 year, you have to then submit a certificate of completion of this training with an advocate on record before the Supreme Court. Then you are entitled to take this examination of advocate on record. Now, it consists of 4 papers, if I'm not mistaken, at that time when I did it. It was one was legal ethics, practice and procedure. Then third is your landmark cases. And then fourth is drafting. I took this examination in, I think, 2014. And I was awarded this certification of being an advocate on record in February 2015. You have asked me another question, that how do you prepare for this advocate on record examination? Now, if you're practicing regularly in Supreme Court, then probably it's a cakewalk to get through this examination. However, this examination is held every year in June and is conducted by Supreme Court. Now, for these 4 papers, it is very important that you first go through the questions which have come in the past year, so that you understand what type of questions would be put to you. And all these are descriptive type questions, and these are very lengthy. And when we, because we lose the habit of writing by hand after so many years into the profession, we are more used to typing it on the computers. So it is very important that you complete those examinations within a time span of 3 years, and those are very lengthy. So you need to replenish and your habit of writing for so long. Then after going through the papers of previous year, you would understand what is the pattern of those papers. Then the next is the examiners. They conduct lectures before the exams. So these examiners are leading advocates, senior advocates of Supreme Court, who are given duty to frame questions that would be put to the students of law who are taking this examination. Now, if you attend those lectures, you would get an insight that what these examiners are going to put. And if you attend those classes with sincerity and carefully, then you may also make a guess that what type of questions would be put to you, because they tend to give a hint during their lectures that these are the important topics where you have to focus. Important in the sense of significant development in law and recent landmark cases, probably these matters are more filed in Supreme Court than often, like filing an SLP. I think more than 80-85% of Supreme Court work is through SLP. Then remaining is through writ petitions, transfer petitions, and other form of pleadings. Then there is a paper of latest case laws. So you would be given a list of 50-60 landmark judgments starting from 1950. Till date, and the examiner would tell you that how to attempt those questions, because those questions are not direct on those case laws. You could be given a problem, and you have to analyze that problem on the basis of those landmark cases, and then give an analytical answer to those questions. And the last paper are drafting skills, which is most important for lawyers. Which test your writing and analytical skills. And the question paper is quite lengthy, because it gives you the facts and then the issues which are involved, and ultimately requests you to write a particular petition. Maybe it could be a SLP or a writ petition or a transfer petition, XYZ. So how do you attempt those questions is first to read what the examiner wants you from that particular question. So if you know that you have to draft a bail petition, then start reading the facts so that you analyze those facts from the perspective that ultimately you have to draft a bail petition. So you highlight those important facts, and then ultimately after reading the entire question, then you start writing the answer. So that will save you a time. Otherwise, if you read the entire question first and then what examiner wants you to do, then again you will go back to the question and then highlight. But if you have read the operative part of that question first, that will save you time. And saving each minute is very important in those type of questions. So becoming an advocate of record is also important if you want to become a standing counsel in Supreme Court for a particular organization or for state or for the Union of India. So that distinction is important, and I think everyone should endeavor to become an advocate on record. That's an added advantage, and why not to take it?
That's great, sir. You have given several guidelines for different students who are aspiring to appear in this particular examination, and you have also mentioned about the enriching lectures. And I must say here that there are several lectures available on YouTube in the channel of Supreme Court Advocates and Record Association. Those are very much enriching. Correct. Indeed, sir. Yes. And sir, as we know that you have appeared in several landmark cases, you have several cases to your credit, even from Supreme Court. So we want to know if there is any interesting conversation between you and judges, and you and opposite counsels. Is there any interesting and memorable conversation that you want to share with us?
Okay. So, courtroom hearings are full of anecdotes and memorable moments. But I think since we are running out of time, I'll share two of those anecdotes. One on a funnier side and one which has made a lasting impression on my career. Now, I'll first tell you about a funny incident. Now, I was arguing one very famous case from Madhya Pradesh, where one gentleman of a illustrious background threw a birthday party, and one of his friends came with a revolver. So this gentleman, my client, requested his friend that I want to get clicked with that revolver. So a strange request. So being a son of a distinguished personality from Madhya Pradesh, his friend gave him a revolver. But before giving a revolver, he took out all the bullets and handed over a empty revolver. Now he took that revolver and danced. Next day, newspaper was full of his images that son of so and so was dancing with a revolver in hand. Ultimately, a case was registered against him on the basis of those newspaper reports under Arms Act. And we were arguing bail before the Honorable Supreme Court. It was rejected by High Court. Now, I argued that having an empty revolver does not amount to custody and possession. Because the friend who gave him a revolver had unloaded the revolver. And therefore, flashing a revolver which is unloaded, empty, is not a crime under Arms Act, and it does not amount to possession and custody of a firearm. Now, we had a heated argument with the other side from the state. There was a senior advocate who was appearing on behalf of the state opposing the bail. And I was saying that this mere flashing is not possession, and therefore I'm not guilty of any of the provisions of arms, and therefore please grant me bail. So the judge jokingly said, to ease the environment, because we had it heated this channel, Mr. Lahoti, it all depends what you are flashing ultimately. So that is, and everyone in the court, after hearing what you are flashing, so everyone laughed in the court, and then ultimately we got the bail. The second incident were of my formative years. I used to be very assertive and sometimes used to increase the pitch of my argument during court hearings. And I was opposing the senior counsel of very high repute. I think I was the junior most in that court at that time, and he was the senior most in that court at that time. So I knew that my case was weak, so I tried to pitch my voice higher and said that no, my client has not done this, and tried to justify the case of my client by aggressively arguing before the court. Whereas that senior advocate very politely and in a very persuasive manner put all the facts and the legal principles to the judge. And I aggressively tried to rebut all those things. So the judge said to me, which is still clear in my heart and which every lawyer must understand and must keep in his mind while arguing, do not raise your voice, raise your argument. It's very important. And that principle of law, of arguing in court, that's a court scrub, which I still follow. And that day, after hearing that particular phrase from the judge, I simply sat down. I said that, all right, my lords, I think my lords have made a very pertinent point. I'm closing my case. But that particular anecdote left an everlasting impression on me and many people who were there in that courtroom. And I would request all my audience, always prepare a case to the best of your ability, have an eye on facts and law, and then pursue the judge with all humility and assertiveness, but not aggressiveness.
Indeed, sir, that is a great advice, and we have to increase the quality of our argument, not the pitch of our voice. That is a great advice to all the participants that those are hearing us. And after that, sir, I want to ask you another most important question. That as we know, drafting plays a very vital role in the career of a litigating counsel, and you have also mentioned that it also plays a vital role in the advocates and record examination. So, sir, please share something about effective drafting skills and what are the most important pointers for effective drafting?
When a client comes to you, he will narrate you his story. He will give documents in support of his contention and in support of his case. Now, before you start drafting, first you need to thoroughly understand your client's case, number one. And how do you understand a client's case? Either by listening to him or by reading each and every document which your client has given to you, and each and every document which the other side or the defense counsel will put to rebut your argument. So firstly, you need to counsel your client about pros and cons of your case. Then read each and every document very thoroughly. And before drafting, read the law on that particular subject. Don't draft and then read the law. Read the law and then draft it. ultimately, if you read the law before drafting, you already have a fair idea of the facts which are involved in your case. And then you have read the law. Then you understand where your case stands. What are the favorable judgments in your favor? And what are the judgments which are against you? When you read the law, you will get all the arguments which have been taken in similar cases. So ultimately, you become knowledgeable by reading those case laws, and you would keep in mind while drafting that I have to put this particular scenario after reading all those judgments, and I don't have to put this scenario. Because what you write is very important. That's the first impression that goes to the judge when he reads the brief. So drafting plays a very important role in getting a relief, in impressing the judge, and also in putting forward the best case of your client before the adversaries.
Indeed, sir. And sir, as you have explained about different skills that are required in advocacy, and you have also given a pointer for drafting, we want to know what are the most important skills for a litigating counsel, and what the skills that you have acquired through decades of practice in this profession.
So, for different lawyers, there are different skills. So far as I am concerned, I think there are five skills which I think are very important in the development of a good lawyer. Number one is that a lawyer doesn't mean that you have to always speak. You have to be a compassionate listener also. So when you listen, you tend to absorb the case of the other side. What his argument is, what his legal tools are. And once you hear him well, then you would be in a better position to rebut each and every argument. But if you don't hear, you won't understand his case, and then you will not be able to contradict or contend what is good for your client and what is good and how it is to be presented before the court. So as a lawyer, I have inculcated this habit to first try to imbibe maximum information, analyze it, synthesize it, and then exercise the judgment to provide advice to my clients and or argue before the court. So it always starts with listening, number one. Number two is be assertive and courageous, but not aggressive, as I told you. Assertion of opinion and making myself heard while remaining respectful to others is one of the key qualities which I think is liked by my peers about me. On the other hand, I believe that being aggressive not only damages the logical thinking, interpersonal relationship with other lawyers or maybe with the judges, it ultimately leads to an uncooperative environment that makes the resolution or adjudication difficult. So raise your argument, not your voice. Third thing is always be creative and pragmatic in giving solution to a problem. Strive for creativity and out-of-the-box solution, yet be pragmatic to the client's problem. Each problem is unique. Each client must be handled accordingly, and each solution is to be carved carefully and which is tailored made for a particular case for a particular client. Fourth is you need to be and practice perseverance, which is very important. success is not achieved without perseverance. You need hard work. You need to keep working, keep trying, keep going. Instead of stopping, keep trying, even things are not working out. Take a break, come back afresh, ready to resolve, negotiate, and whatever the matter may require, but persevere. Don't leave it half-hearted. And the last is that is be a compassionate achiever. Compassion is an essential quality with which an advocate perceives a client's problem and genuinely work to resolve them. Until and unless you have an empathy for your client and for your client's case, you won't be able to give a pragmatic and a compassionate solution to him. Without compassion, no one can understand what adversary's position would be or anticipate what he or she will do in the court or what type of pleadings they would present before the court. And if you are not aware or if you can't empathize or compassionately think, then it would be difficult to take preemptive steps to safeguard your clients. So these are, I think, are the five major qualities that every lawyer should imbibe, should have.
Great advice, sir. And I think who all are viewing us today, they will get some inspiration from all these advices and they will adhere to all these pointers. And sir, as we know that you were placed under the prestigious BW's 40 under 40 list in 2020. It is one of the most prestigious lists and it is given to honor the skills and talents of those lawyers who are greatest in their fields. So sir, what are the most important criteria that one should possess to get there? And how was your experience with BW Legal?
It was very humbling to be part of such illustrious list. In fact, Business World had for the first time came with such kind of award last year. The process of nomination and selection was quite simple. It was a two-fold methodology which they adopted. The first step was that you have to submit a nomination form about your practice areas, your achievements, and your experience. And then you have to prepare a elevator slide, which is one pager. In one page, you have to present yourself before the jury about your work and achievements. Because on the basis of that elevator slide and your nomination form, you would be shortlisted for the second round. Now, the second form, the second step is the interview stage. BW was fortunate to have jury members who are the most renowned advocates and practitioners of law in this decade to preside as a jury. And I was privileged to have my candidature considered by such jury. They were asking questions about my life and the law practice, how was my transition from a law firm to my own independent practice, about my personality as a whole. And it was a long interview, I think of 15-20 minutes, and each and every person was firing questions on you to test your patience and test your personality. So after that process, and many people have applied, and I was fortunate to have been selected among the top 40 candidates to be part of that prestigious list. Although there was no specific quality which can make you a part of such a dynamic list, what I believe is, for winning an award of such a nature, you need to practice empathy, do hard work, and persevere. So perseverance, hard work, and empathy are the most essential qualities for winning any award.
That's great, sir. And it is very true that perseverance, empathy are very much important to win any art. And it will be helpful to each and everyone who will be viewing this video. And that is a great thing that you have advised us. And we congratulate you again for winning that particular art, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. So, sir, before parting with this particular interview, we'll ask you one last question. So, sir, if you will be given a chance to go back to your law school, is there anything left, or do you have any regret that you couldn't do during that particular span, but you will do if you will be given another chance?
Well, although I don't regret, because I spent my college days very well, but yes, if given a chance, I would read more biographies and autobiographies. They teach you life lessons and encourage you to fight against adverse circumstances. They give you wisdom, which is different from knowledge. And why I say that knowledge is different from wisdom is that knowledge will tell you what to say, but wisdom will tell you when and how to say it. Ultimately, these biographies are the life which has been spent well by legends, by legal stalwarts or jurist, but they will give you a formula to become a winner.
Indeed, sir. That is a great quality of yours. You love reading it, biographies, and that was one of the most important reasons that compelled us to invite you in this particular show. You read them and you take inspiration from all the biographies. And it is a great advice to all the juniors who are watching us today. So thank you, sir, for joining us today. Sir, it was a great honor to have you on board for this interview session. You discussed your life lessons, and your legacies. And those will be treasured with us forever, because this video will be preserved in the YouTube for all days to come, and it will be viewed by all the legal aspirants who want to follow you and who want to take inspiration from your life. So, sir, thank you for joining us. And before ending this particular session, I would request Devasis to come on the screen and to propose a particular vote of thanks. Devasis, please.
Yes. Thank you, Jyoti Prakash, for calling me out here and asking a number of relevant questions which were given by sir in a very particular way and which were quite enlightening. And I was listening to them all through this in the background in the studio. So I am really sure that this will be helpful for the law students who are viewing this and who will view this in future. So as we have come to the end of this particular interview session, I, Devasis Kumar Panda, on behalf of Team Lex Cognoscenti and Jyoti Prakash Datta, would like to extend my heartfelt thanks to you, sir, for joining us, giving a lot of pointers, lot of valuable inputs and views, and a lot of things which we have got. And I and Jyoti Prakash, we are both sure that we have learned a lot of things from this particular interview session, and a lot of viewers who will view this in future will surely learn. So thank you so much, sir, for consenting to this particular interview session and sharing your life story, your experiences, the knowledge that you have regarding the legal profession, AOR, and other things to us and to our viewers. We are really privileged. We are really honored. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us.
And I must congratulate Lex Cognoscenti for organizing these interviews sessions, which you called Rendezvous. Because ultimately, what you are doing is you are bringing people to the students instead of students going to the to those people whom they aspire. Now, by doing that, these people are imparting and giving their life lessons to the students to learn, to imbibe, and to follow, so that the mistakes that we have committed should not be committed by you. and you go far further ahead of all of us as a budding lawyer, maybe in litigation or some other avenues, by taking inspirations from the guests that you are calling in these rendezvous sessions.
Thank you.
This means a lot. This appreciation will strengthen us even more. And we wish you perennial health and prosperity for all days to come, sir. Thank you.
Same to you. Thank you. Thank you so much.